गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी। हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीबॉडी। गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग सर। वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग। वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
Okay, just put your good morning in chat message. Put your mic on the mute mode.
Good morning.
Keep your video on, but keep your microphone on mute mode. Just going live. We wait for 1 or 2 minutes, and then we are having our first session of paper presentations. I hope all the paper presenters have entered the room, because the room is already full now. There are already 250 participants. If anybody else is now trying to enter, they won't be able to enter the room. They will have to watch it live, either on Facebook or YouTube channel. Good morning once again to everybody. We are very thankful to everybody for your vehement response in this webinar. We have received more than 1300 registrations from throughout India. Almost all the states and union territories are covered as a representatives in this webinar. Very thankful to everybody for your interest in this webinar. We have received more than 125 presentation applications also. So many of you have sent your abstracts. We selected 80, which are somewhere in and around the main theme of our webinar, that is literature and epidemics. The all abstracts we are not able to select. Many of you were late in submitting the abstracts. We were not able to include your abstracts because they were late. The quality was good, but yet we are not able to, because we already scheduled all the presentations. I hope you are browsing through the website for all the upcoming events. All the schedules, all the live, all the links are updated on the websites. Right now, even on the website, the live streaming is embedded. So if anybody is asking you that they are not able to enter, just suggest them to go to the website. And there, from Facebook and YouTube, the embedded videos are being live streamed there. We have scheduled throughout the day on that also. This session will run around
10:30.
We will take a small break up till 12:30, and then around 12:30 we will again assemble for official inauguration by Honorable Vice Chancellor. And we will have the first plenary at 12:30. As soon as the first plenary ends, we will have second plenary. I would request Shakirul Sheikh. Yes, Shakirul Sheikh, please mute your sound. Please mute. Yeah. Yes. Dr. Jagdish Anera also. Yeah. Everybody, just tap mute on your microphone because you don't have to speak anything here. Only the paper presenters, when their turn comes, they will unmute and speak here. This is Nirmala Bala. Tap on stop presenting. Nirmala Bala, mute your sound and stop presenting. Yes, Nirmala Bala, if you are listening, just tap stop presenting. We know that we all are learning. Yes, Nirmala Bala.
Tap,
stop presenting. Just tap on stop presenting. Yes, we all are learning things. This corona epidemic has given us an opportunity to work from home. It has given an opportunity to run seminars, conferences, workshops, online, on remote mode. We all are not very good with technology. So maybe the people will keep on peeping inside with sound on, some kind of disturbance will keep on coming. But we understand that this is something new. We are doing it almost first time. So we will bear with all the problems, even during the plenary if some sounds are coming. We hope that everybody will bear with it. But just the instruction that just mute your sound. When you enter Google Meet, you are seeing two icons. There is a microphone and there is a video. You just have to tap on red color. It will change to red color and then only enter. So there is no problem of video or your audio coming down there. This is Kalyana Sundaram. Your sound also is on. Yes, everybody. Again, presenting. This is Ritesh Revdiwala. Don't tap on this. Now you tap stop presenting. First you tap okay, fine. Ritesh Revdiwala. Okay. Don't do the presenting unless you are going to present the paper. And everybody, put your sound muted. Everybody put your sound muted. Within 3 minutes, we are starting our first presentation. I hope all the people who are there to present today, they are ready with your turn.
Hello, sir. Sorry to interrupt, sir.
Sir,
this is Thomas. Sorry to interrupt. Hello, sir. Can you hear me, sir? Hello, sir.
Yes.
Yes, sir. This is Thomas, sir. This Nirmala is couldn't respond to any kind of message. Why? Because she couldn't unmute her mic also. I sent message also, sir. So will you please send the chat box through the chat box? We'll send the message to her, sir.
Mute la ponnama. Mute la poda solranga microphone.
Nirmala ma'am, please mute your mic. Please mute your mic. When the presenter asked you, at the time you present. Okay. You are getting unnecessary noise. Nirmala ma'am, can you hear me? Ma'am, please respond. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you.
Yes, please mute your mic. Unless the presenter asks you.
I am muting her, okay? Nirmala.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, fine.
Hello.
Yeah. All the paper presenters of today's session, are you in? You just put a chat message if you are inside. Those who are going to present a paper in this session, just put a chat message that you are there. Yeah. Okay. Vaidehi madam is there and she is going to anchor the. This is Professor Ashwini Kumar Mishra. Please mute your sound. Okay. Okay, Vaidehi madam will invite everybody to make their presentations. So if in case somebody is not able to work it out with technology, then you can orally speak what you want to say. Let your PPT be presented on your screen. And we have to stick to time, only 8 minutes that you have to give your views about what you have prepared for this presentation. So I would request Vaidehi madam to come on screen and announce for the first presenter.
Good morning, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. You can put your video on if you want to.
Yes. Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Department of English, I welcome you all on this national webinar about literature and epidemic. Some instruction before we start. The paper presenters will be given 8 minutes to complete their presentation. After the completion of 6 minutes, I'll give a warning so that you can wind up in 2 minutes. So let us invite today's first paper presenter, Ms. Ahuti Dhandukia. Ahuti ma'am, are you ready with your presentation?
Yeah, she is getting ready. Yeah, she is getting ready. Yeah.
So next,
a minute.
Yes. And next is Asha Dedi. Asha, you be ready after this. Thank you.
Hello, good morning.
Yeah, Ahuti, you'll have to present again. Yeah.
Sir, is the screen shared?
Yes, it is streamed live on Facebook as well as YouTube.
Sir, is my screen shared?
Your screen is not visible. Again, you have to share.
Okay, sir.
Yeah. Okay, we are able to see your screen now. Yeah, please continue. Yeah.
Yes, okay, sir. So, very good morning to all of you. And considering the time constraint, I am proceeding to my paper title, The COVID-19 Pandemic and Literary Responses on Social Media. We all know that epidemics are the inevitable reality with us, and they have been present with us from the prehistoric time to the present time also. And they are the global pandemics, especially are the global health emergency, and they are one of the major cause to disability, death and illness also. And WHO has declared COVID-19 as the pandemic on 11th of March 2020. We all have experienced that this disastrous pandemic has devastated all our existing systems, starting from our personal life to the domestic front to the, our professional academics and the rest. And not only our systems, but our values, which are established by literature, by culture, they are also reverted, they are altered, they are changed, and they are challenged. For example, right now, our Indian ideal of Atithi Devo Bhava has been at stake. And even the communication through haptics are also, the meanings are also altered. And so these values are enshrined by literature and humanity, and this is significant and relevant to study literature and epidemics. The objectives of this paper is to study the regional response to the global phenomena of COVID-19 pandemic through literary
and the communication through haptics are also the meanings are also altered.
To study contemporary literary writing on epidemic as posted on social media during ongoing pandemic, to examine the range of diverse concerns addressed in these literary responses on social media, as well as also to examine the linkage between the current socio-political events and their representation in these literary responses. And one purpose is also to examine the literary form explored on social media through the current corona crisis. Why the researcher has selected the literary responses on social media? Because COVID-19 is perhaps the privileged pandemic to involve the literary responses on social media. And social media literary responses also reflect the literary consciousness, current literary consciousness, as well as contemporary climate. And they also refer to the current socio-political events. Many responses are impromptu writing, and the extra advantage we have is that of they are posted under the hashtags as well as the comments also, and social media friendly new literary forms are also emerging and becoming popular also. And we have to validate these literary responses on social media as standard literature. Diverse concerns that are addressed through this literary writing are the juxtaposing the affluent and the daily wagers, the isolation in home quarantine, reverse migration by the laborers, stigma attached to corona infections, rising death toll, and degenerating the decency of death, because death is turning to the figures only. Enormous hunger and food robbery, vulnerability of the old, poor, and the laborers, and lack of coordination and ruthlessness by the government. Literary responses posted on the two Facebook groups, Stree Art, as well as Gujarati Lekhak Mandal. And from Stree Art, of course, I have selected only the leading literary responses, and one writer is Swapnil Mehta, and he has posted under this hashtag of corona effect, and most of his writing appears as microfiction. And microfiction is derived from flash fiction, and it is extremely brief in the word count, but at the same time story element should not be missed. And traditional aspects of creativity and imagination are also preserved. And striking element is that microfictions begin as well as end abruptly. There are very vivid dramatic scenes also. And it has been, because of its brevity, extreme brevity, it has been emerging as a social media friendly literary form. And here the leading responses include one parody of that, neither the parrot is hungry nor the parrot is thirsty. Like this, affluent people are engaged at home in the lockdown period, and their craving for the freedom and some higher values are expressed over here. Here in the bracket, I have mentioned the date on which in these Facebook groups these posts are uploaded. And he one very imaginative aspect is that Swapnil Mehta's one literary response includes the press advertisement, just like that matrimonial advertisement or hiring some domestic help that can talk with him, with the very rich person who has been the corona survivor. So it shows that even the family members consider corona as the stigma and they stay away from such persons even after curing from this disease.
And ma'am, you have 2 minutes more.
Okay. And one imaginative aspect is also that of the mango dialogue. Two mangoes on the mango tree are making the dialogue in the form of microfiction itself. So trees are also affected, and trees are also seen as one entity in this pandemic. And another is that of coronavirus is personified, as the Daitya, as popularly we see, but as the human character. And this several of Swapnil Mehta's literary responses, microfictions, refer to the dialogue between coronavirus as well as the narrator of this microfiction. And the coronavirus threatens, and sometimes the coronavirus is defeated, and significantly these messages are conveyed. And there is one very interesting meeting held by different kinds of coronavirus, American and Wuhan, and one virus is boss, and like this, and the meeting discussion is also going on. Then the next important element, personality, is Mukund Pandya. And Mukund Pandya writes in free verse as well as in microfiction, and including these dramatic scenes also. And most of his writings refer to the journalistic responses. Then we turn to this Gujarati Lekhak Mandal and Tanmay Timir. He looks at this news report of these migrating laborers, and they appear as the ant. And from that, he just turns to visualize himself also as the ant locked, and those who are breaking this lockdown, they are compared as the brave crows, and like this. And flower showering for the corona warriors, this has been recurrently referred to in these literary responses also. And the laborers' responses to this flower showering has been expressed also. And free verse is that. Now we turn to the next is Manishi Jani. And of course, in Manishi Jani is a free verse, again the anti-ant looking, the laborers looking as the ant is the recurrent image that we find over here. Even that candlelight burning reference is there. Generally, we have also experienced that there is a close linkage between the literary responses as well as this media coverage also. The journalistic link is there, and all these events, socio-political events, are getting the fictional representation even in the microfictions also. And the limitation of this study is that generally the face of literary responses on the Facebook, we have to validate it as the literature still. And the only two Facebook groups are selected in which the researcher has the access to, and this is still ongoing process. Many posts are still being uploaded, so the study can still go on also. And these microfictions may be lacking in its scale, but they are very, very sharp and intense also. And just to sum up, that COVID-19 will be remembered as the historical global phenomena to rethink about the values and ways of life. There is need to consider literary responses on social media as literature. Literary responses to epidemic on social media are significant, as they are the reflection of current climate. Impromptu writing is also not missing in imagination and the creativity also. Microfiction as literary form may not be exploring, but certainly it is revealing. And microfiction is a social media friendly literary form, because it can appear even as your WhatsApp chat also, and which like the needle pinches us to draw a few blood drops to diagnose the inner maladies and the plague inside of humanities. Thank you.
Thank you, Ahuti ma'am. Now I would like to invite Asha.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Ma'am, Ahuti ma'am, you stop sharing your screen.
Just a minute.
Yeah. After Asha, Hema Goswami, you be ready with your presentation.
Now it is stopped, na?
Yes, it is stopped now. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
No, even if they do not stop, if the next person will start sharing, then automatically it will switch over.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, okay. Put your mobile on mute. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Good morning to all of you. My topic for today's paper presentation is apocalyptic fiction, reality or reference in COVID-19 pandemic. So as we all know that we all are in a big crisis in which COVID-19 turned the world into hell. Globally, people are dealing with COVID-19 and this contagious disease tuning the world upside down. So the fear of virus imprisoned the human being in their homes, and surprisingly, as a kind of relief, people were become more attracted towards pandemic fiction. So here I have taken one movie which is of course very popular, is Contagion. So some of the objectives of my presentation are how do we see this movie playing a vital role in this scary reality as references and ease your worries. Then what apocalyptic pandemic fiction teaches about the present situation. How did this film predict the forthcoming disaster? Are these movies are potential enough to overcome fears of inevitable disaster? Or are this pandemic fiction a tool to escape from horrible reality? So before we jump into deep, let's see what is apocalyptic fiction. So apocalyptic fiction is a subgenre of science fiction or science fantasy in which the author visions to imagine the end of the earth or some big disaster in which the human community suffers. So apocalypse is a Greek word which means revelation and unveiling or unfolding things not previously known and which could not be known from the unveiling. So pandemic fiction is also a part of apocalyptic pandemic fiction. So here I am going to find similarities between Contagion movie and current situation, coronavirus pandemic. So let's see some significance of Contagion movie in COVID-19 pandemic. So as we are passing through a terrible outbreak called coronavirus, some people claim that the 2011 American thriller film Contagion, a science fiction film, predicts the COVID-19 years ago, which is directed by Steven Soderbergh and written by Roger Burns, follows the spread of virus to animals to human beings. So here is one quote, which is said by Lori Jarrett, is also one consultant member, and she also wrote one book, The Coming Plague. She said that Contagion as a movie, which is part fantasy, part reality, and totally possible. So as we see that as a Contagion and as an apocalyptic fiction about pandemic, now potential enough to present reality with a scientific fact. So let's find some of the similarities between this both situations. So the origin of the virus in both the things are similar. So if we see in a movie, then there is origin of virus is from a bat who dropped the banana and which is eaten by a pig. And then a chef prepare food for their customers. And here is one image which shows a chef who was shaking his hands with bath embryo, which is considered as the first index case in this movie. And if we look upon the present situation, then there is a suspected origin of novel coronavirus is also a bat, which is not reality, but it is suspected. And scientists are still working on that, and origin of that particular virus, epicenter is Wuhan, China. Then other similarity is the transmission of disease. So the virus portrayed in contagion and coronavirus both are similar in their spread. It spread through respiratory drops in air or touching by one another, or if we come in contact with infectious person, then it can spread. So there is one dialogue that on one day there were two people with it, then there were four, and then it was 16. Seems that the it seems that the R of COVID-19 is 2.2, and the R of ME1 virus, which is described in contagion movie, is 4. So there were some similarities between transmission also. Then other are similar symptoms. The people who became affected by the spread of coronavirus or ME1 virus experienced similar symptoms, like in the film they experienced high fever, cough problem, problems in respiration, then sweating, high headache, sore in their throat, and also had seizures, dizziness and instability, and throated from their mouth.
And this Asha, you have 2 more minutes.
Okay, ma'am. The next topic is how we can see the contagion movie as a reference to the current situation. So if we see, then people are naturally going to turn to Netflix because of escapism. They want to escape from the situation. So people find relief in the lap of the other similar movies which highlight the current situation. Why? Because these movies can be considered or taken as a reference to deal with this scary reality. So the more realistic film, Contagion, is completing itself without any villainary figure. Here, the virus itself is it can be considered as a villain. So, in this way, the apocalyptic science fiction provides reference points for our anxieties during a time of global change. And there is also one terror management theory. This theory is basically said that when everyone has a fear of death, people are scared in this pandemic, and they all know that life is limited, so they will die one day. But they don't want to accept the reality, and as an option, they turn towards this pandemic fiction. As the Catherine rightly remarks, that this current pandemic crisis makes me terrified, and a story about exactly that same thing. Is one way to grapple with that fear. So to sum up, it can be said that Contagion regained a lot of attention by presenting strikingly similar scenario which we experience now. And this is a totally accurate representation of beginning, progression and consequences of a painfully relevant phenomena which we are facing now. This movie is trying to uncover the anatomy of global pandemic, which involves political gaps, bureaucratic challenges, as well as other outer responses after community spread of virus. And people also get a shimmer of hope that everything will be normal again. So this is how Contagion as a fiction remains significant and effective as a reality, as well as a reference to a current pandemic. Thank you. Thank you, Asha, for
this presentation. Now I would like to request Hema to begin her presentation. And after this, Jill will be ready with the presentation. I would like to request Ms. Parul to please mute the microphone. Thank you.
Hello, good morning. Today I'm going to present my paper on the topic Humanity in the Time of Epidemic, the Role of Sharing. Myself, Hema Goswami. So, as we all aware of and its meaning also. So, well, what this term has to do during the time of epidemic? The answer is obvious. We can't neglect the quality of being kind and understanding during the worst time that our nation is facing. Now, to elaborate this term, let me discuss two kinds of people. The one who are self-sacrificing by nature versus the one who are self-centered. Self-sacrificing are the people who are giving up what they need or want in their life. They are doing this just to help others. Whereas self-centered are the people who are thinking about themselves only and not about others. They are doing nothing for the benefit of others. So how during the time of epidemic, these two kind of people react? How they are facing this kind of deadly disease? We know that this is not the first time when our nation is facing such kind of worse problem. Epidemic and pandemic are occurring so many years before also. And during that time, we have faced this kind of people also, as we are seeing in present tense while facing COVID-19. There are police, doctors who are working 24/7 for the benefits of others while sacrificing their personal need. Whereas there are also the people who are breaking all the laws, rules and regulations and just thinking about themselves. They are responsible for making the present situation worse. Now, let me come to the point that what is the role of literature in shaping humanity during the time of epidemic? We all know that literary writers keep on writing and reflecting the reality through their piece of art. They are portraying lifelike characters who are fighting against deadly disease, and they are also portraying the characters who are not playing their role and duties during the worst time. So from this depiction, we can discriminate between good or bad. We can mold our behavior by reading these records of literary writers, and then we can connect the situation with larger truth. In a way, literature in a right way. To elaborate the role of literature, I will explain in brief the novel by Albert Camus, The Plague. I have taken total 5 major characters from this novel who are representing humanity and who are making difference between self-sacrifice and self-centeredness. The first major character is Dr. Bernard Rio. He plays outstanding role in the novel by self-sacrificing nature. He has sacrificed everything to play his duty. He is the first in the novel who has dealt with the first victim of the plague and requested to the authority to take action. But we all know that how authority is working. The second important character is Jean Terieu. He is the one who has organized a team to fight against the plague. According to his thought, everyone needs to fight because plague is everyone's responsibility, not the responsibility of suppressed people only. Third character, important character is Raymond Rambeau. But in the beginning, we have seen this his totally different nature, who is trapped in a city and trying to escape. He had did so many things to leave this city of plague. But at last, he has decided to stay in the city. He has helped many people and he feels like Oran is his own city. And it is his responsibility to fight with plague. Fourth character is Joseph Grant. He has also joined the team of volunteers to fight against plague. So these all characters are the example of self-sacrificing nature during the time of epidemic. Through this character, we can learn basic lesson of humanity. While in this novel, there is also one most important self-centered character, Father Penelou. He is not contributing anything, but only rising threat in the mind of innocent people. He used to give threat in the name of God. He has given sermon by saying that epidemic is a kind of curse for the God, by the God. When one innocent child died, then he said that it is the test of faith in God. In a way, he is making only excuses to remain aloof from all these self-sacrificing people. I have only taken one example from literature But there are so many from which we are learning the lesson of humanity during the time of epidemic. Even from the film also, we can learn the lesson of humanity. We have learned from record so that we cannot repeat past mistakes. We have to be reason for the nation development, and we have to fight together. So this is all about my presentation. Thank you for listening. Stay safe, stay healthy.
Thank you, Hema, for this presentation. Now I would request Jheel Bharat to come up with her presentation. After this, Mr. Nimesh Dave will be ready with your presentation. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. I am Jheel Bharat, student of SYBA from Bhavnagar. I am going to present my paper on topic the relevance of the plague in contemporary crisis. Everyone can see my paper? Is my screen visible?
No, Jheel, your screen is not visible.
Is it?
No, not yet. Yes, now it is.
Is it presenting my PPT?
Yes. Yes, you can start now.
Topic of my presentation is relevance of the plague in contemporary COVID-19 crisis. Introducing my paper, this paper attempts to view the facts and similarities portrayed in The Plague by Albert Camus on the context of contemporary COVID-19 crisis. Reading of The Plague has manifested some striking similarities with the real life happenings of ongoing corona pandemic. The situation, the predicaments of characters, and the vital choices they have to make in the given circumstances are surprisingly similar to our time. This paper will try to present some of the arguments regarding the relevance of the facts and similarities in the novel The Plague with the situation in which we are living for last 4 months. Arguments of my paper are, literature have already suggested some epidemic steps to prevent it, yet human beings fail to learn historical lessons from the historicity of the literature. And the second point is, literature is considered to be fictional, while it's more real than factual. That's why Aristotle said, the truth of literature is more deeper and far real than the facts of history and the truth of philosophy. Presenting my views, the main character of the novel, The Plague, Dr. Bernard Ricks, knew about the emerging epidemic plague and he tried to awaken the government of Oran. And similarly, Dr. Li Wanglian of Wuhan knew about the emerging respiratory virus. In this era of internet, he presented his view on internet. We were foreshadowed about the situation, but we never think about anything and move with thought will be given as it falls. In the novel, The Plague, Doctor requested government to take steps, but they kept on discussions about it and were worried about the economic of the country. They preferred to wait and watch. Same happened in this era. The doctor who shared about the virus on the internet was blamed and arrested for spreading fake news, and China tried to suppress this news. In The Plague, the government of Oran was not ready to take any steps. The main aim of society and government was to earn money. What's the difference between the Wuhan and Oran? Economics was priority than human life. Livelihood is far more important than human lives. Fake beliefs which are common in both the era. The people of that time had same fake belief to today's time of change in situation would come with change in atmosphere. We feel virus to disappear with increase in temperature, while in America, people feel it will disappear with decrease in temperature. Whenever the difficult challenges enter into life, people choose to be refugee of religion. One of the characters in The Plague, Father Panelu, sermons to the followers that plague is the punishment of the sins till now. Similarly, relating to COVID-19, according to the report of Hal Hazira, head of Jamaat, announced the same in YouTube audio message. He also said that if gathering in mosque is infectious, then this notion is worst. Also in Los Angeles Times, religious leaders said that no need to follow government orders as America has right to worship. And also in Karnataka, 200 people gathered for Rath Yatra. There are some challenges seen in that era and this period too. Burial of dead bodies. There was great news of mass burial in Iran. Maximum cases in New York were noted of around 11,268. They started a ritual of mass burial. First, the prisoners used to dig burial, but now they contracted to dig a burial. Hoarders increased. In The Plague, people wore raincoats with a thought that it would prevent them to prevent plague. Hoarders started black marketing of raincoats and life necessary things. Such issues are not seen in our country, but foreign countries, there seemed a shortage of toilet papers. As they bought it in a large scale and the sales increased by 40 to 160%. Some common solutions of both the epidemic are seen. They are people are quarantined in order to minimize the infection among the citizens. There seemed increased awareness for cleanliness and help for needy. Volunteers came to help in that time and this era too. The plague and plague came to end. It took 10 months for plague epidemic to get normal, but corona is yet present. That era took around 10 months. What about the present time? This industrialized, globalized, technological era will take 10 months or 20 months. Even if corona leaves, hand cleaning and mask will become an important part of our life. Perhaps gathering of more than 4 people in public will be a crime. Malls and cinema halls will turn to hospitals with compulsory isolating wing. Studies will be online. Perhaps actors coming closer will come with a warning, being closer for more than 2 meters is crime, away while actors are drinking and smoking. Concluding my presentation, I would like to say that it is believed by some historians that from the history, human beings have learned nothing but one thing, and that is humans have learned nothing from history. Thank you.
Thank you, Jill, for this interesting presentation. Now I would like to request Nimesh to present his presentation, and after this, Ms. Pooja Trivedi, be ready with your presentation. Thank you. Yes.
Now, is it visible or not?
Yes, your screen is visible. Now you can start. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. I am Mr. Dave, student of PhD at Department of English. Today, I am going to talk about literature from Homer to present day. A study of paper. It would be appropriate to begin the paper with the words of Franz Kafka. One day in 1904, he wrote a letter to a friend defining the books that are about reading. I think we ought to read only the kind of book that wound us. But if the book we are reading doesn't wake us up with the blow to the head, what are we reading for? So that it will make us happy, as you write. We need books that affect us like a disaster, that grieve us deeply, like the death of someone we loved more than ourselves, like a suicide. A book must be X for the frozen sea within us. The words of Franz Kafka are very relevant in the present context. It is a time for all of us to look within, to break the frozen sea that is within and wake up in the time of pandemic. Because literary writers had many a time wrote about epidemics. It is widely accepted definition of literature that it is mirror or x-ray image of society, presenting uglier and darker sides of society. So through the present paper, we try to ponder upon such texts that how it shows the realistic picture of that era, and also learn that how even though these texts are fictional, it warns or say predicts future in an allegorical way. Time and again, humanity encountered many pandemics like plague, smallpox, influenza, cholera, and whatnot. Neither pandemic nor its presentation in literature is this phenomena. Since Boccaccio's Decameron to the present day, this wide variety of texts that offers grim pictures of epidemics that possibly harm the entire world. So, in the present paper, we have a bird-eye view on some of the texts that features epidemic in its narrative and also try to read effects of epidemic on society. Boccaccio's Decameron, composed in 14th century, which inspired Geoffrey's Canterbury Tales, provides an authentic description of pestilence that in Florence. Daniel Defoe's A Journal of Plague Year aptly captures the bubonic plague struck in the city of London in 1665. Daniel Defoe's words are important to quote here. Defoe narrates, even letters were purified by the postman. He caused the porter to smoke them with vinegar. Then he had them drawn up by the pulley. Then smoke again with strong perfume. And with a pair of hair gloves and hair outermost, he read them with large reading glass, which he read at a great distance, and as soon as they were read, burnt them in a fire. And at last, distemper raging more and more, he forbid his friends writing to him at all. So this is important to understand that how there were such extraordinary precautions taken for the disease. Pulitzer Prize Killer by Barry Mayer is about opioid epidemic, exposes the roots of most pressing health epidemic of the 20th century. Between 1999 and 2017, estimated 2,50,000 Americans died from the overdoses involving the prescription pain, a plague ignited by Purdue Pharma's aggressive marketing. Families, working class, wealthy, have the part. Business destroyed and public official pushed to the brink. Station 11 is 2014 novel by Emily St. John Mandel, which takes place in the Great Lake region after fictional swine flu known as Georgia flu, which has devastated world, killing most of the population. McCarthy superbugs. The race to stop an epidemic is about antibiotics and fight against the drug-resistant bacteria. Here is a list of some of the best pandemic novels. Fox by Michael Wilrich, about smallpox epidemic swept the United States. The American Plague by Molly Caldwell Crosby depicts the story of yellow fever and its terrifying reign. The Coming Plague by Laurie Garrett. The Demon in the Freezer and the Horror by Richard Preston. Emerging Epidemics by Madeline Drexler, World War Z by Max Brooks, The Pig by Albert Camus, Zone 1 by Colson Whitehead, The Sand by Stephen King, Read by Mika Murray, Great Influenza by J.M. Barrie, Virus Hunter by Seiji Peters. And now, when we try to look on the Indian literature, then we can find many traces of epidemics also. Devastation caused by outbreaks infected major writers across India, Rabindranath Tagore, Premchand, Suryakant Tripathi, Nirala, Mohan Senapati, Takashi Shankar Pillai, and others, giving birth to the haunting poems, short stories, and novels. The first modern poet of India, Suryakant Tripathi's memoir, Kulli Bhat, or A Life's Misspent, which published 16 in English version, captures the misery of Spanish flu that swept through India in 1980. Indian soldier in British Army who has participated in World War I returned home, becoming unwitting carrier of the disease. He also lost his wife and daughter in this outbreak. He describes how there were no wooden logs left which to create the dead, and even Ganga grew heavy and seemed exhausted with the burden of corpse. The Hindi writer Premchand Idgah, also a young boy Hamid's father, dies because of cholera. In Dudh Ka Dam, also a character dies because of plague. Father of Odia literature, Fakir Mohan Senapati writes in his well-known Rebati that how many people die due to cholera.
Nimish, you have 2 more minutes.
Tagore's long poem Puran Bhati, okay, tells the aching story about smoke which killed many more people. The same is the case with the Sharad Chandra Chattopadhyay's work also, where malaria is an inevitable part of life. It is interesting that villagers had a wreath of deities responsible for the disease like plague, cholera, and smallpox. Sahitya Academy Award recipient Malayalam writer Gankadans also explores about the smallpox that was in the village. In Kannada writer Yuvananth Murthy's masterpiece Samskara, one of the main character Narayanappa dies because of plague. Phaneshwarnath's Mela Anja also captures malaria, cholera, and other epidemics that havoc in the society. Ahmad Ali's Twilight in Delhi is about Spanish flu that killed millions of people. It would be appropriate to quote Ahmad Ali's words that thieves stole sheets from the graves and gravedigger raised their fees fourfold during pandemic. They did not bother to see that graves were properly dug or not. They had so many more to dig. Now, it is what we have to observe from this thing is that people believed behind occurrence of such diseases original sin or God's punishment to human beings. People were believing in blind faith and religion, then science and rational thinking. But slowly they started doubting that God will not allow his children to die. The scientific temperament led people towards industrial revolution. To conclude, I would like to say that pandemic, it is almost same in all narratives that large number of people suffered and died in epidemics. Cemetery were full of dead bodies. There was no one to bury them. In such literature, one may find inhuman society. Epidemics are also a great leveler without discrimination of caste, class, gender, age, religion, or nation. It is affecting one and all. It is appropriate to quote the words of Hill Lippo that in literature of pestilence, the greatest threat isn't the loss of human life, but the loss of what makes us human. But life won't stop. It goes on. Such pandemics are like speed breakers, which seizes or slow down the life for a while. So let's learn something from it and make a better tomorrow. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Nimish, for your presentation. Now I would like to request Ms. Pooja Trivedi.
Yes, I'm ready.
Okay, Pooja. After this, Samia will be ready with her presentation. Thank you.
Is it visible presentation?
No, your screen is not visible.
Just a minute.
Yes.
I have shared my presentation.
Yes. Now it is visible.
Okay. Is it okay? Presentation is the first slide came.
No, not yet.
Should I do it again?
No, Pooja, minimize the screen.
Yes just okay. Minimize
the screen. I did it. Now is it visible?
Yes. Yes. Desktop is visible.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you for your
F5.
Okay. Greetings to respected sir and all on the friends. I am Pooja Trivedi, a research scholar of PhD from Bhavnagar University. And today my paper is titled as Dystopian Anxiety in Pandemic Literature, a Study of the Scarlet Plague by Jack London. All human things are subject to decay, and when fate summons, monarchs must obey. Death is the ultimate reality of life. And in the initial couplet of his famous lampoon, Mac Flecknoe, John Dryden has presented this reality that we have already known that we are going to die. However, and counter with the fear fact that we could all die, that the entire human species could be wiped out is terrifying. Hints of mortality is nothing new for us. It has our religious roots also. In our religion, we have three deities like a preserver, creator, and destroyer. So we have already known that we are going to die. The world is going to end someday. In the present scenario, in the 21st century, the outburst of this excess of nuclear disaster movies, alien attack scenarios, end of the world narratives, they all give hints of mortality. Pandemic literature is an alternative on the theme. Perhaps in some ways it is more frightening because its conceit is true probable. We see people are dying in numbered hundreds and thousands day by day. The cases are doubling day by day. So that's why it becomes more frightening. Basically, pandemic literature is a category of dystopian literature. Dystopias are nothing but the antithesis of utopias. Dystopian world is such a utopia in which things have completely gone wrong. And in dystopian literature, our current condition was predicted in the pages of a novel or a drama or anything. Dystopian literature presents the reality, but it was not negative. It does not present always the pessimistic side of life. It gives a ray of hope. Dystopian literature presents a fresh perspective on the problematic issues, and it soothes our anxiety to accept the changed world. I would like to quote the words of a famous American novelist, Lauren Oliver here. Dystopian novels help people process their fears about what the future might look like. Further, they usually show that there is always hope, even in the bleakest future. Pandemic is basically a story about disease itself. Illness is a part of life that we know. But why pandemic is more fearing? Pandemic literature mirrors two things, two important aspects. It's like a movie. In the first half, a problem or crisis is shown, and then in the second half, revival is shown. So pandemic literature mirrors two important things, our fear about disease and societal collapse. At the same time, simultaneously, it presents revival is possible. The novel that I took for this presentation, it is The Scarlet Plague by an American novelist, Jack London. The Scarlet Plague is a dystopian novella. It was written in 1910, but not published in the same year. Later on, it was published in a serialized form in London Magazine in 1912 and in book form in 1915. It is a post-apocalyptic American story that deals seriously and philosophically with the society's decline. It has a protagonist with a desire to rebuild civilization. Here I have presented three pictures which shows the Scarlet Plague properly, perhaps. The first one is a pre-plague situation where civilization is well established, then sudden outbreak of the disease, and at last the last man remains in the world. So fundamentally, what happens in the novel is London presents the idea seriously and philosophically. The story takes place in 2073, 60 years after an uncontrollable epidemic, the Red Death, in 2013, which depopulated the planet. James Howard Smith, the last man alive, who narrates all the things that he remember about the civilization before the Scarlet Plague broke out. Through the mouthpiece of James Smith, London has detailed the way in which the world fell the victim to the Scarlet Plague in 2013. grandsir is recounting to his grandsons how he witnessed the plague destroy the world he knew and loved, how mankind fell from its high culture into an anarchy when plague hit. And in the novel, Jack London notes that all the world is topsy-turvy and it has become topsy-turvy since the plague. He says that how people were not alarmed in the beginning about the sudden outbreak of the disease, and if they believed that science or medicine will find some way out, but they were shocked when science failed and it was too late to stop epidemic. People started to run away from the cities, to run away to the home, but they cannot run away from the plague. There was no escape and the civilization collapsed. The new era began with the barbaric civilization, but humanity collapsed and the world survives. So this is the summary of the novel. Now what we get from the novel is, it is a reflection on morality and justice to the contagion. It presents the clinical features of the disease. London has focused on the behavior responses to a pandemic, how people react when pandemic comes. It shows the emergence of fear, irrationality, and selfishness in a previously civilized and modern society. Now, how this scarlet plague written before a century ago is relevant in a present COVID-19 scenario? So the scarlet plague feels contemporary because it allows modern readers to reflect on the worldwide fear of pandemics, a fear that remains very much alive. It gives opportunity to explore the non-medical dimension of the fears associated with contagion diseases. It does not offer the scarlet plague or any other pandemic literature does not offer readers a prophetic look into the future, but this narratives about contagious disease hold up a mirror to our deepest fears about our present moment and explore how it is possible to respond in a positive way. I would like to conclude my presentation with the words of D.H. Lawrence in his novel Lady Chatterley's Lover, that there is a way out at the end of every pandemic. So the ray of hope is given. And basically, the Scarlet Plague says about what we should not do during this epidemic or how we should respond when the crisis begins. So the quote of D.H. Lawrence says, like, ours is essentially a tragic age, so we refuse to take it tragically. The cataclysm has happened. We are among the ruins and we start to build up new little habitats, to have new little hopes. It is rather hard work. There is now no smooth road into the future, but we go round or scramble over the obstacle. We have got to leave, no matter how many skies have fallen. So ultimately, like all other pandemic literature, we blame civilization for that, but we are at the part of civilization, how we react to the pandemic and how we react to the crisis, that is important, because the world has to survive if humanity collapsed even. At the end, I would like to say no success in the solo efforts. So thank you, Bharat sir, for this opportunity. And I would like to thank my friends and family members for helping me out in making this presentation. Thank you all. Goodbye.
Thank you, Pooja, for this presentation. Now I would like to request Samia Kagri to present her presentation. After this, Ms. Ushma Bhatt, please be ready with your presentation. Thank you.
Hello. Hello. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Acha, ma'am. Hello everyone. My today's presentation is on Oedipus Rex, formulations of human tendencies.
Just a minute. Samia, are you presenting the presentation from your phone?
Yeah, ma'am.
Then please rotate your screen.
Acha, ha. Okay.
Yes, thank you.
My presentation is on Sophocles, Oedipus Rex by Sophocles, formulations of human tendencies in the times of pandemics. How basic formulations of human tendencies is formulated, that is we can see by order, orientation, communication, exploration, communication, work, activity, exactness, repetition, manipulation, subtraction, and creativity. Sigmund Freud introduced a psychoanalytic theory as a concept in his Interpretation of Dreams, which was published in 1899. Why a child suffers from Oedipus complex? What are the reasons behind? Freud attributed the Oedipus complex to children of about the ages 3 to 5. He says that if previously relationship with the parents were relatively loving and non-traumatic, and if parental attitudes were neither excessively prohibitive nor excessively stimulating, the stage is passed harmoniously, then Oedipus complex, I think, cannot be seen. If experiencing its opposite, then the chances may be there that the concerned children may attract towards either of the parental sex, Oedipus or Electra. If it is there, it can only be repressed by the concerned child when identified with the same sex, and it can be made possible only in maturing state of mind. It seems as tuning between parents is must for child's proper growth, both mentally and physically. Disturbance in parents' relationship creates disturbance in children's life. Then also a question strikes in mind: what about those children who are already abandoned since childhood or who are destined to grow on their own? Then orphanage-like concept came into being, where due to many circumstances, a child has to succumb in. Either parents are dead or abandoned due to some personal gains and circumstances, as we are going to see in Oedipus Rex. Then, we may think that if we are thinking all this, then what will be the resultant effect of this? The child who has gained the proper environment as per her or his status will be able to deal with challenges, situations, circumstances healthily and courageously, while the person who has faced lacking in such things will have damaged psychology and also some health problems due to improper care concerning food and environment. In some cases, it is seen that it is happening that a concerned person is able to come out from such trauma. Other cases show inclining towards criminality, and in some, swiftly influenced in, and happens that a dignified person comes in the form of Masiha in concerned person's life, and his or her life is changed, but it is in temporal state. But don't know why it is happening that the time which is left out somewhere back, and a person who is not willing to recall or wants to memorize that left out fraction is very strong, that it drags person against his or her wish. The story which is untold or incomplete autonomously, trying to complete on its own, sweeping along that person. It is somewhat of sublimation state, which we will see further, don't seem to be a scientific approach. Any applied logical reasoning which seeks from the concerned person to complete the incomplete part and then to close the part of any story, then what is it? Seems to be as destiny itself seeking person to its naturality. that is somewhat related with need, where that person is not having control on himself or herself, but the nature has overpowered him or her with its hidden vibes, unconcerned about either of the categories, positive or negative. It will get revealed only after the chapter is getting over, and only the person's status will narrate the proceeding story. And if it is going to become a proceeding story or not, that only the time will tell. Seeing this thing in context of Oedipus Rex, the term Oedipus complex derived from the Theban hero Oedipus of Greek legion, which in Freud's words is a desire for sexual involvement with the parent of the opposite sex and a concomitant sense of rivalry with the parent of same sex, a crucial stage in the normal development process. That is something, concomitant sense of rivalry is what the mother is doing. The same, the person with the same sex is reacting, or we can say reflecting to the situation. Oedipus in Oedipus Rex. Oedipus Rex is primarily centralizing the character called Oedipus, who at present is the king of Thebes and Jocasta's husband, who is in search of Lois's murderer, as the plague-stricken situation can only be controlled if Lois's murderer is caught, and so he took help of his brother-in-law Creon and sometime of Tiresias. Moving forward,
Samia, you have 2 more minutes.
Okay, ma'am. Moving forward, now focusing in on finding Lois's murder, and the task is assigned to both simultaneously, Creon and Tiresias, lastly revealed by the latter, and eventually Jocasta hangs herself to death while Oedipus gouges his eyes, becoming physically blind, and finally exiles himself from Theban. We will only touch upon the last part. Lastly, it is shown in the novel how such factors damage the hero's psyche. He is suffering with anxiety. It is for Oedipus, worrying about his daughters. Guilt has married his own mother and killed his own father. Disheartened, disappointed, as something unexpected is imposed on him through his own fate. Isolated, hopeless is Oedipus's present state. If the king himself is disheartened and loses hope, what will become of the Theban people, which we are seeing in pandemic context, which is not shown in subsequent manner, centralizing only the hero. The novel is getting finished, and in succeeding manner, other versions of the same novel is published, but in different manner. Not plague-stricken people or guilty Oedipus is shown. Only the novel's proceeding part is shown. Some striking questions when I was doing process for this were striking in my mind. Is myth itself is a psychology? Is it appropriate to perceive that what is thought by one is reflected on others' life? As always, it is experienced and seen that a concerned person's thinking and psychology can only have impact on his or her life. Has myth regardance with sublimation? How would it be if something on science or reasoning was predicted and it was happened in person's life? Research outcomes are this. Formulations of human tendencies has its own reflections on concerned person's life, either in negative or positive manner, or by a mixture of both. If proper environment, nurturing and care are acquired in infancy and childhood, it will have its positive outcomes in person's forthcoming life, because the environment acquired by any person, and if it is in negative manner and with lackness, though temporary, with aid of someone, it has temporary benefits. But as this myth led Oedipus to its ultimate fate, similarly, the concerned person is liable to. everything which is thought by a person or the forming surroundings, which is having somewhere its order, is compulsively going to happen. People, if think scientifically or mythically or spiritually, does not matter, but should think positively, it may have its beneficial impact on person's life. Because if one thing has its positive connotations, it also having its negative connotations. And it is up to one how he or she takes any particular situations or circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you, Samia. Now I would like to request Ms. Ushma Bhatt to start her presentation.
Yes, a request to everybody that stick to time, don't take much time and make your presentation longer. As the day will move on, we will have a very hectic schedule. And in the evening also, perhaps maybe late evening, we may go tomorrow quite early, around 8 o'clock, we'll have to start. So those who are making presentations tomorrow morning shall be here by 7:45 in the morning. And everybody, again a request, stick to the time so that we can manage everything in due time. Yes, Ushma.
Ushma ma'am, are you there?
Ushma, you have not unmuted your mic. Unmute. You are not audible. Yeah, unmute your mic. Yeah. Yes, Ushma. Okay, if she is facing any problem, then we can take the next one.
Sir, ma'am's voice is also not audible.
So right now take next one. I think she has not unmuted the mic. That's why that problem is coming. So you can take next one.
Yes, sir. Next is me. Start the presentation.
Start. Okay. I would afterwards. Yeah.
Yes, I would request Ahuti ma'am to just keep a watch on time. Is my screen visible?
Yes, it is visible. Continue.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. The topic for today's presentation is From Airplane Mode to Power Saving Mode, Myth in the Times of COVID-19 with reference to Ramayana and Mahabharata. So I would like to quote Albert Camus' quote from The Plague. From now, it can be said that plague was the concern of all of us. Similarly, COVID-19 is a concern of all of us. And we can see that how from China, it began to start spread quickly into the entire world. So this epidemic is not new. It has been captured in different forms and different phases. And literature has been an excellent art form where you can see it's capturing it in literature. Challenges in epidemic. Right now we are seeing a lot of challenges like food crisis, medical crisis, people are homeless, kind of economic crisis. Among all of this, there is a mental health crisis as well. We see many people are going in different kind of mental health issues as well in this lockdown. So generally, airplane mode is a mode in which the data is off and you are disabled in using your cellular data while you are traveling, and it does not create any interference while traveling in airplane. Apart from that, we can also see power saving mode, which saves the power. Sir, am I audible? Right. Hello.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Sorry. So airplane mode, it generally switches the cellular data, so there is no interruption while traveling, and also you find that your device is safe. Now here, airplane mode is seen in a different way, that right now we are being on airplane mode, so we are not able to do the normal things which we used to do, like social gatherings or going to college, family functions. In this time, myth particularly is trying to serve as a power saving mode. Now we can see that nowadays there are lots of TV serials coming on television about myth, like Ramayana, Mahabharata, and many religious serials. Now myth is generally has a lot of different definitions, like some says it is a lie or something untrue, while other says that it is true and it is profoundly true, and some also claims myth has some universal truths. Now the question arises here is that myth is a lie, or myth is the most profound truth possible to human beings, or it has a certain kind of universal truth. In his course of Greek and Roman mythology, gives four tools to read myth, that is functionalism, structuralism, Freud's interpretation of dreams, myths, and rituals. So the functions of myth are to delight and entertain, to teach us something, sort of the structure of it, legitimizes social norms and social values. Myths are the dreams of entire culture, and some of us are always engaged in the process of myth making through culture, dreams, beliefs. According to Britannica Encyclopedia, the function of myth is to inspire.
Now, when we are talking about the perception of Ramayana and Mahabharata, there are different views we find that some it is a kind of promotion, or some say kind of diverting game of the government, some political agenda. Now, the perception is not there. India, what please made them? It almost a new record of years. People are writing a lot of analysis about this on Facebook, on Twitter. What does the myth say? Now, if we go back to Albert Camus, we can see that he has included the myth of Sisyphus. Now, Sisyphus, myth of Sisyphus says that to do the thing, even if it doesn't have a body. Similarly, we also see that Ramayana and Mahabharata has some certain kind of tragedies like war, or you can say Vanvas. What Vanvas? Right now, we can consider this Vanvas as a lockdown as well. We are not going to the forest, of course, but we are in a kind of a Vanvas, we can say. So all this myth somewhere brings a kind of a tragedy. And tragedies are always something people would love to hear or maybe try to connect with them. So to conclude my topic, the researcher would say that what could be the possible reasons of myth getting so much popular in this COVID-19? So one of the reasons can be in waiting for Godot will come tomorrow, a kind of a hope in hopelessness. So people are getting certain kind of hope through the myth. Also, a kind of a placebo effect is created by looking at the myth and looking them suffering. A kind of a sympathy or a kind of a catharsis is developed. And as in Sanskrit scripture also it said, Charevati, Charevati. So whatever the situation is going on right now, COVID-19, now COVID-19 or post-COVID-19, the life does move on. Now myth, if it is life or somewhere, it's kind of a hope. So to conclude, I would say that मुझे मालूम है कि ये ख्वाब झूठे हैं और ख्वाहिशें अधूरी हैं, मगर जिंदा रहने के लिए कुछ गलत फहमियाँ जरूरी हैं. So thank you very much. And this are the works I said.
Yeah. Okay. Next one.
Next, I would like to, if Ushma ma'am is ready, otherwise Namrata can present her presentation. Ushma ma'am, are you ready?
She is sharing her screen. Yeah, okay. Yes, we are seeing your screen now. Yeah, play the PPT. Yes, you are. Start showing your this. Don't type anything. Hello? Yes. Yeah, okay. Yes, Ushma, start. It is visible now. Ushma, you have not unmuted your mic. Ushma, unmute. We cannot listen you. Tap on the microphone. Yeah, go to the meet, tap on the microphone and come back again for sharing. You have not unmuted. Okay, if who is the next one? If ready, then let us take the next one.
Yes, Namrata, are you ready with your presentation? Then you can start. Namrata?
Are you there, Namrata? Unmute. First, unmute your microphone. So, if you are speaking anything, we can listen. Yes, Namrata is there, but yes, Ushma.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, audible. Continue. Yes. And be quick, okay. 5 minutes. You have to end within 5 minutes. Okay. Yeah?
Okay. Now I'm explaining everything by my own only. Then I'll show the
picture. That is very good. Yeah, please continue.
You can see my face, and I'm trying to show you that pandemic. The very first thing I want to clear, that pandemic is taken as a transnational disease. That's why, as I'm having a diaspora obsession, so I named it as a diaspora disease. And I also named it that coronavirus has been coming from Wuhan to America and America to Mumbai, and everywhere it has been transforming. So it seems like that, but the disease has spread everywhere. And disease is showing the identity crisis also. Person lost his identity when he dies, or if he or she is quarantined, then it seems that he is losing his identity. So basically, the coronavirus has shown its diasporic identity, and it has shown a purview, and that's why it is known as pandemic and plethora. In my presentation, I have taken some of the non-fiction historical epidemic related books, which I could show in my presentation, but I think if the time constraint, then I can't show the last slides of presentation. Could I, sir? No, sir. If time allows me, then I want to show 3 to 4 slides in the...
But I think you won't be able to show, and it will be time consuming. So you can conclude orally your presentation. Yeah.
Okay. Then I have taken the slides of Randall Packard. And he was the novel of Randall Packard, and he told very fine, beautiful quotation, that there is a very beautiful quotation that every disease claims its own history, and every disease has its own story of the all over the world. That's why this particular Randall Packard's novel, it has become very famous. Its name was White Plague, Black Labor, Tuberculosis, and the Political Economy of Health and Disease in South Africa. In the same way, there was another non-fiction narrative of Nancy J. Bristow also. She wrote a very fascinating novel, and that novel was regarding the book of pandemics, which happened in 1918 till 1920. It was the pandemic of influenza, which happened in around the globe, all over the world. James Dusku has also written another non-fiction novel, and that I have taken only for the sake of showing that pandemic helped the people of Canada who had lived over there, and who were the aboriginals. They were not getting food, and they were suffering from starvation. But due to this pandemic, what happened actually, they got the food packets, and the state government supported them, and the government supported them, and the disease also, pandemic also supported them. So this disease and pandemic, and state government supported the aboriginals and even the migrant people. So in that case, the epidemic had become a kind of a blessing, a privilege kind of a thing. Then there is one another book also I have taken only for the sake of showing that plague, cancer ward, or influenza, or any other particular disease that happens all over around the world had its own evil value, because it is evil, by the way, and on the whole we can say that it is evil. And evil all over the world, in evil itself, has a self-destructive ability, and this self-destructive feature itself diminishes the evil. The pandemic is also an evil element, and in the same way as it happens in R.K. Narayan's Man-Eater of Malgudi, the person dies only because of his evil in himself. In the same way, this Alexander Solzhenitsyn's book, The Cancer Ward, that novel itself suggests that evil is self-destructive. There is a very fine quotation by Ken Poirot, which I knew. It was about evil is self-destructive, and it is its cannibalistic force engorges upon evil, and evil itself dies. In the same way, this coronavirus will also is an evil element, and it will certainly become dead, because evil itself is destructive. So that is the main thing which I have found in this purview of pandemic and plethora. Pandemic becomes plethora, and plethora is evil, and evil itself is destructive. Finally, the good wins. That's the main conclusion part of my this topic of the research paper. Thank you, sir, and thank you all. It is over now.
Thank you, Ushma ma'am. Namrata, are you there? Okay, Namrata, now you can present.
Good morning to all. Is my voice clearly audible to you?
Yes.
Wait. Now I am trying to share my screen. Can you able to see my screen?
No, not yet.
Hello, ma'am. Hello, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
Yes. I am again try for it.
Yes.
Wait. I tried a lot, but I can't share.
Within 2-3 minutes, if you can speak up, what is your topic about? Orally, you can present. You can keep your camera on and yes. Orally present.
Yes. Okay, sir. Because my network is very low, about my topic of this research paper, I choose movie. I choose a contention movie because it becomes very famous after COVID-19 influence in the world. This movie directed by Steven Soderbergh and written by Scott Burns. The plot complete public has the loss of social order in the pandemic and the introduction of vaccine to halt its spread. The plot concerns the same situation in which we live now. under the influence of COVID-19 epidemic, I have identified 8 aspects of contagion movie, which very similar to the present prepared. Hello, ma'am. Hello, Vaidehi, ma'am.
Yes, you are audible, Namrata. Go ahead.
Hello. And first of all, I want to say something about coronavirus. We all are know what is coronavirus because we live in its dangerous situation. But we should know about its scientific meaning. Corona, common colds. They are transmitted primarily via respiratory droplets and contact with contaminated surfaces. They are often seasonal coronaviruses. I want to discuss about the three human corona viruses, and these all coronaviruses are beta coronaviruses. First is SARS-CoV-1, and second one is MERS. Means this movie contagion is based on epidemic. Throughout the movie, we can see that this virus of MEV1, and here this movie is based on hyperlink narrative, and this movie is based on scientific. So everyone should watch this movie because we can win this present situation of COVID-19 through this movie. Recently, I have watched this movie and the real situation through this movie. And here I want to say something about the comparative analysis of the movie Contagion, which is released on 2019. Research paper about the comparative aspect is, first is the virus origin, second one is similar symptoms, transmission, and unproven remedy. For example, forsythia, and fifth one is, here I want to talk about the first aspect and about it is the virus origin. If you see this movie, then you can see the in the final there is an important and reveal that the fictional MEV1 we can find MEV1 virus originated from a pig that ate a piece of banana roped by an infected bat, escaping the destruction of its palm tree forest habitat in China. And that pig is then slaughtered and prepared by a transfer, and thus transmitting the virus to her in-hop becomes the index case in this movie, meaning she was the first identified case of this virus in this movie. And if we compared this aspect with the present coronavirus, I want to say that bats are considered by some epidemiologists to be the possible source of the coronavirus.
Okay,
one
so
one theory on the origin of the current coronavirus instead the influenza may block.
We request you to conclude now. Yeah?
Okay, sir. Many aspects with the comparison and we can find the symptoms which we can compare it with. There are there are many many symptoms, including headaches and sore throat, which we can also feel in the present situation. And third one is transmission. Here we can see in the movie that like COVID-19, the films, everyone is respiratory disease carried in expelled droplets of saliva from a spread directly between people when those droplets reach the eyes, nose, or mouth of an uninfected person. In the present situation, we can see that in coronavirus transmits through the we can say that Beth Emhoff is the main character in this movie. We can say that the Beth Emhoff is the first case affected by MEV1 virus. We can say that the transmission chain starts with the Beth in Macau casino, where she infected many people and those people traveled worldwide and affected the maximum countries. We can say that globalization harms us. And thank you, sir. Presentation is completing now.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, stop sharing your screen now. Yeah, hello. Thank you to Vaidhi Haryani for anchoring this session. And we are thankful to everybody, all the presenters and all those who are participating. Thank you all of you for this session. We are ending this session, and at 12:30 sharp, we are again meeting for a formal inauguration and first plenary talk. Our Honorable Vice Chancellor will be present in the session to inaugurate. And we will have four speakers, Dr. Atanu Bhattacharya, Dr. Kamlakar Bhatt, Dr. Kalyan Chattopadhyay, and Dr. Abhishek Puri joining us for that session. So thank you, all of you.